Good morning, everyone. If you can please take your seat at this time, thank you. Well, good morning. My name is Ivo Daalder. I'm the president of the Chicago Council on Global Affairs, and we're so pleased to welcome you to our annual International Women's Day Global Health Symposium, Innovation for Healthy Futures. This is our fifth Global Health Symposium, and I'm sure by now the very best attended one, so we're very pleased to have you all here. This symposium is our flagship event in the Women in Global Development Forum, a dynamic series of programs that explores the vital issues facing women and children around the world. As many of you know, the Chicago Council is an independent, nonpartisan platform, so we don't necessarily share the views of all of our speakers, and in any case, they are not the views of the Chicago Council on Global Affairs, they are the views of the individual speakers. We do have a view, however, as the Council, an important view, which is that the United States of America has to be engaged in the world. That engagement was important when we were founded in 1922. It is as important today in the year 2017. And the topics we cover today, I'm sure you will all agree, American engagement is not only a welcome, but often an absolutely critical effort. From our USAID work to the many NGOs working across so many sectors in every corner of the world, having the United States an active partner in pursuing peace, prosperity, and freedom is important. The elections we have just concluded have brought a renewed debate about America's role, and indeed a sense of concern and urgency about many of the issues that our Women in Global Development Forum covers, both here at home and abroad. Today, you will meet changemakers, innovators who are challenging stereotypes, harnessing the power of networks, creating pathways to equality in education, in earnings, and health access with renewed vim and vigor. For International Women's Day this year, we are asked to be bold. And I think that boldness stands with the marches that were organized across America and the world on January 21. A loud and clear signal was sent about continuing down this path to equality and access for all. And I say all because I believe we all need to be involved in this journey. I was one of the marchers in January with my wife and our two sons. Didn't wear a pink pussy hat, but I was there. Because I see a need for all of us to play our part in raising our voices and the voices of others on the challenging issues of our time. Today you will hear from our speakers and their respective organizations, and I have to say many of them are very bold in their pursuit of their dreams and activities. Many of them believe the world may be a little bit more fractured this year than the last time we gathered here. But today we are here to work on that and explore how innovation, storytelling, and immersive technologies are catalyzing change to improve the lives of women and children around the globe. All the details of what is happening today in your programs, so please consult those rather than waiting for me to read them. As you can see, this is a packed room, crowds beyond where the eye can see. Might tweet that, actually. But this crowd is only made possible as the symposium is supported by countless people and institutions, and we're extremely grateful to you. First, I would like to thank our sponsors who continue to believe in this series. Many of them have been with us since day one. Our lead sponsor, Horizon Pharma, our supporting sponsors, Abbott and USG, our patron sponsors, the Frankel Family Foundation, the Holt House Trust, Ashley and Avery McCall. Thank you for your continued support of the Council and the Women and Global Development Forum. As always, we're delighted by the number of students who are attending here today. Thank you for being here and for participating in these important discussions. What happens tomorrow depends on what you start doing today. It's through our sponsors' support that we are able to facilitate student group participation. And as the next generation of leaders, I hope you feel inspired to take action and address global challenges and be bold in whatever you do. We're also delighted to have partnered with 22 nonprofit organizations who have been engaged in developing conversations you will hear here today. Thank you, one and all, for your partnership and everyone here in the room and around the world watching us on live stream for being part of our conversation. Turning back to today's program, we are on the record. We're live streaming. So please do silence your phones, but participate in social media as much as you can. And now it's my great pleasure to welcome to our first introducer to the stage, Ms. Noreen Clary. She's the Senior Director of Compensation, Benefits, and Corporate Services at the USG, our lead sponsor for the event. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Good morning. As we just was introduced, my name is Noreen Clary. I'm the Senior Director of Compensation, Benefits, and Corporate Services with USG Corporation. We're a leading manufacturer of building products. For the last 115 years, USG has developed groundbreaking products that have advanced the entire building industry, such as sheetrock, gypsum wallboard panels, and have helped millions of people. I'm thrilled to be here today at the beginning of what will be an incredible day. This marks the Council's fifth annual Global Health Symposium. Each year, the symposium has grown in attendance and is increasingly attracting a more global and diverse audience, as you can see from looking around the room. Most of us are here today because of the topics being discussed are particularly important to us and to our companies. I know that they represent some of the most important corporate values at USG Corporation, including a commitment to health and safety and a spirit of innovation. We work hard to ensure that our global workforce has the ability to operate in the strongest health and safety environment, and we are committed to developing and manufacturing building products that improve the safety and security of the built environments in which we all live, work, and play. But the reality is that an estimated 400 million people around the world lack access to basic health services, including family planning, prenatal care, safe childbirth, child immunization, and access to clean water and sanitation. From urban to rural health challenges and across the globe, it is often the poorest people, women and children, and vulnerable populations that experience limited access to health care and unmet medical needs. Now more than ever, there is a greater need for increased cross-sector collaboration and the collective action among companies, governments, and NGOs to impact health. Innovative approaches, ideas, and technologies are improving health outcomes and changing health care. Today, we will learn about some exciting initiatives and organizations that are making a difference in providing equitable access and improved health outcomes. And we'll discuss the challenges and opportunities to improving equitable health care. I hope you've had a chance to see our speakers' bios. They should be popping up on the screen. But please allow me to highlight a few of their additional achievements. Pam Bolton is the Vice President of Global Health and Innovation at Concern Worldwide. She brings to her role a special focus on meeting the needs of women and children and is leading Concern's innovation in maternal child health. Mary Davis is the CEO of Special Olympics International. They currently serve nearly 5 million athletes with intellectual disabilities. She is a long-term campaigner for the rights and inclusions of children and adults with intellectual disabilities and has been appointed to many Special Olympics international committees throughout her career. George Hampton is the Executive Vice President of Rheumatology and Primary Care Business Units at Horizon Pharma, where he leads the forward-looking strategy, as well as establishing operational goals for both business units. Previously, he served as President and Chief Executive Officer of a privately held technology company and spent time working with Abbott Immunology, now AbbVie. Funmi Olopade is a Walter L. Palmer Professor of Medicine and Human Genetics, the Associate Dean of Global Health, and Director for the Center of Clinical Cancer Genetics at the University of Chicago. She is an oncologist specializing in cancer risk assessment and individualized treatment for the most aggressive forms of breast cancer, and has developed novel management strategies based on an understanding of the altered genes in individual patients. And last but not least, our moderator, Dr. Maryam, is the Vice President of Programs at Matter, where her goal is to improve healthcare through strategies that encourage collaboration across multiple sectors. She is the founding member of the Cyberkinetics Neurotechnology Systems, Inc., a startup that commercialized a brain implant that is aimed to restore movement in paralyzed individuals, as well as the founder of the Center for Device Development at Northwestern University. We are lucky to have such a diverse group of panelists who are making a difference in healthcare for those that need it the most. We will take questions from both the stage as well as through our online survey application. The link is currently displayed on screen, or will be shortly. There it is. If you have an internet-enabled device, please type chi.cnf.io directly into your browser and select today's program. Thank you.
Thank you, Noreen, for the kind introductions. So we'll just jump right into the discussion. So today, for your first panel, we will discuss three different topics tied to equitable access and improved health outcomes. For starters, we'll talk about global access. That is a really topic on top of mind for many of us in the U.S. right now, as Obamacare is potentially going to be repealed, and with sort of the Trump care, the topic of access comes to mind and is discussed frequently in the news and among our peers. So this is a chance to actually think about it globally, and how are your respective organizations, providing access or helping with access? So maybe let's start with. Let's start just generally, and then we'll kind of get into some level of detail. So Pam,
thank you. And before I start, I just want to say how delighted I am to be here with all of you in Chicago. It's such a great group, and for us in Concern, it's wonderful to be involved with the Chicago Council. Concern Worldwide, the organization that I work for, has been involved in fighting extreme poverty throughout the world for the last 50 years. So we are very concerned about equity of access to resources and assets, access to markets, access to health. And while we work across a wide range of areas, from helping farmers grow more nutritious crops or getting them to market more efficiently, or improving water and sanitation, or improving, giving greater access to education, health is really a big part of what we do. And because equity is such a huge issue in health, I think that has driven some of our work. Now, I work in maternal, newborn, and child health. When I was in public health school, the thing we learned was that of all the indicators tracked by the World Health Organization, maternal mortality, death to women, associated with pregnancy and childbirth was the one that showed the hugest disparity between rich and poor countries. And that is all about access, because many of the life-threatening complications that women experience are not so readily predictable, which is the normal thing, you predict and prevent in public health, but a lot of those aren't. And when they happen, like hemorrhage, you have to be able to manage them. So a health provider and a health system has to be able to manage the complication as it happens, and that's exactly where the difference is between poor countries and rich. So Concern is working in poor countries at community level, very much so, and addressing the parts of the population who are most vulnerable, which are women of childbearing age, women who are pregnant and delivering, and the youngest kids. And maybe just one more point about that. The most dangerous day of a baby's life is the day that baby is born. So that is one of the areas where really we are placing a lot of effort.
Wonderful. So George, next. So what are incentives for a company like Horizon Pharma, a mid-size biotech company, to invest in innovative technologies and models of care? What are you doing to improve access across the world?
Well, that's a lot of questions. I think from an incentive perspective, there's two things, right? It's the internal incentives within the company to reach our goals of bringing innovative medications to patients worldwide, new and innovative. Externally, there has to be really two things from an incentive perspective. There has to be a reasonable path to approval. through the FDA or any of the worldwide regulatory bodies. And then secondly, there has to be the potential to commercialize once you have approval. And so sometimes those marry up very nicely, and sometimes they don't. And that often puts barriers in place for new molecules that would be very interesting to certain patient groups that are struggling to, without anything to combat the disease. And so we're working very hard on those. From an access perspective, we're a little bit unique. Our founder suffers from rare disease. I think everyone on the executive team, including myself, have very personal connections to patients that are suffer from rare disease. And so we have kind of a guiding premise that if the physician and the patient close that office door and make the decision on what medication they need to be treated with, and that's one of our medications, that patient will get that medication no matter what. If they have commercial insurance, we will work to help them get that paid for. If the commercial insurance denies it, we will pay for it. And we did that to the tune of $1.4 billion last year. To put that in perspective, thanks. To put it in perspective, our gross sales were over $2.5 billion. Our net sales were only $1 billion. So we're giving away more than we're keeping. And that's I think, a pretty special thing for a mid-sized company to do.
Wonderful. So Mary, you're a long-term campaigner for the rights and inclusion of children and adults with intellectual disabilities. So how has access to healthcare improved those with intellectual disabilities?
Well, thank you, Maryam, and like also Pam, I just want to say how delighted I am to have the opportunity to talk to you this morning about my particular area, which is for people with intellectual disability. And Special Olympics caters for over 5 million athletes and their partners, because we offer a comprehensive program for people without intellectual disability also, so that they can come together on the same playing field and learn from each other. So we're an organization not just for people with intellectual disability, but one from which young people in particular and people of all ages can learn a great deal about the possibilities of people who are different, and also to learn about difference and how good actually that difference is. And I know that's a great issue in the world today, and I believe that our athletes are to the forefront in teaching others to understand difference better. So obviously we undertake our program through the medium of sports, and sport and health go hand in hand. And in relation to health and opportunities for people with intellectual disability, they are one of the most underserved population in the entire health, in the entire area, in the entire health area. And, for us in Special Olympics, we offer a comprehensive health program. It's called Healthy Athlete Program, and we have catered for 1.7 million screenings that have taken place at our various different events that happen both globally and at regional and local level in 130 countries. And even though we operate as an organization in 170 countries, our health program still hasn't reached all those countries. So we have considerable work to be done. But the great thing is that we have trained 155,000 health professionals in the area of intellectual disability. And that's really, really important in terms of providing resources and ensuring that healthcare professionals are well educated, because that's one of the barriers that we face all the time. And we do that through seven disciplines. So anything from optometry to audiology to dentistry to healthy minds, strong health, to physical therapy, etc. So volunteer professionals, doctors, care workers come to our events at all levels of the organization and undertake those screenings. And it's amazing some of the stories that have been told and that I've seen personally myself as a result of the intervention through those screenings. But follow-up care is often an issue for us. So whilst we can undertake the screenings, if there isn't follow-up care, which is again one of the barriers faced by people with intellectual disability, then that's a huge issue. So some of the barriers we face are in terms of stigmatization as well. So many in many of our cultures and societies worldwide, there is still a stigma around intellectual disability, and even in developed countries where we think we've come a long way, their lives are not as valued as others. You know, we had a case recently right here in the US about a year ago where a child, baby Lily, was refused a heart transplant because she had an intellectual disability. And that's sad because everybody's life is of value, no matter who we are, no matter what we are, and we must understand that. Some of the laws in some of the countries as well is a great barrier. So you have mental capacity laws in some countries where the athlete with an intellectual disability isn't the decision maker and somebody else is making the decision for them. And what sort of decisions are they being made? Some people with intellectual disability have undergone sterilization, etc., where they have been institutionalized where they shouldn't be in many cases, and they should have choice and equity as everybody else when it comes to healthcare opportunities.
Thank you. At Matter, the topic of access comes up in many of the solutions that we have. So oftentimes it's through telehealth applications where the startups provide care through kind of virtual connections to the patients or to the specialized kind of communities that need them. One startup that comes to mind that's sort of relevant to taking trained professionals who have a specific skill set and making them accessible to the communities that need them is a startup called Mind Matters that was developed by a veteran and connects therapists who have specialized training to work with veterans, with the veterans who need them, who are spread out all over the country. So we have quite a few of those. And so another startup at Matters called Cancer IQ. It's led by Funmi's daughter. And they provide access to pre-screening tests in to communities that would otherwise have a hard time having access to them. So can you tell us a little bit more about that, Funmi?
Yeah, so I am an oncologist and a geneticist. And one of the things that's really clear to me is that we're in the era now where we can use genomic information to improve health. And we can do it cheaper, faster, and we can develop it in a way that assures equitable access to better health for all. And in fact, one of the biggest research initiative now is the precision medicine for all, and it's all of us. And for us to be able to get all of us into better health, and we need to study populations all over the world. We need to know the genetic basis of every disease that we study. And over again, when we do clinical trials, we find that minority populations are excluded in every study. So part of what we're trying to do, I'm a university professor, but we also have to really begin to think about innovative ideas that will get us out of our elite institutions into the communities. And that was the idea behind Cancer IQ, that everywhere, all over the world, more than 2.2 million women are diagnosed with breast cancer. And too often, they wake up with a lump. And we, in our work, we found that these women actually show up to a doctor, but because they don't even have a word for cancer in their language, it gets neglected. It gets treated as tuberculosis, you know, an infectious disease, a boil, until the cancer is metastatic. And so globally, we need to come together to figure out how to use innovative tools. And even in this country, you know, on the south side of Chicago, where I work, in rural communities, in suburban communities, there are people who don't even know what genes do, right? Let alone going to ask their doctor, am I at risk for a cancer? and can I do a genetic test to help me manage my risk? So that's really why globally we're thinking about innovative solutions to chronic diseases. Because the challenge for women and all of us who are here, thank you for showing up again. And I hope that next year we'll double this room. Because chronic non-communicable diseases is not a problem for men only. It's a problem that is impacting women globally. And when you have a chronic condition and you have no money, and because I'm an oncologist, you have cancer, you have no money, it's the worst thing that can happen to you. So that's why we have to come together. Now we all came together to fight HIV/AIDS, and the global community needs to come together to help women battle obesity, to help women have drugs for hypertension, diabetes, and then cervical cancer. We have vaccines that can actually cure a lot of these cancers or prevent them, and yet we're not getting them to the people who actually need them. So we're really looking at innovations in that space. In this country, we could virtually eliminate cervical cancer. And guess where we still have a lot of cervical cancer? In poor, minority, underserved populations. We need to get girls vaccinated. Our vaccination rate in this country is 30%, right? It's unacceptable. So we really need to figure out how we get broader access to life-saving medications and life-saving vaccines for women and children globally. I must not end before I actually acknowledge that I wasn't supposed to be on this panel. It was Zuwera Yusufu, who is the chief executive officer for Dangote Foundation, that was coming all the way from Nigeria to participate in this. Dangote is a billionaire that has put money down to say there are women in northern Nigeria. There is a famine in northern Nigeria now where women and girls are dying. And we all need to be in solidarity with the troubled spots all over the world and figure out innovative solutions to feed children so that they can grow and have brain power, to feed women so that they don't have children who are born with disabilities because they didn't have enough folic acid in their diet. And we need to come together as a city, and I'm so proud to be in Chicago during this period, because Chicago works, and we have to play a part in making sure that women all over the world have better access to care.
Thank you. So we're going to move on to our next section. And as you can see from the polls, we have not only representation on the panel, but also among the group here that ties into foundations, non-governmental organizations, and private industry. So everybody's here. All the stakeholders are here. And the next section, we'll discuss, like, where are there opportunities for partnerships across the industry? And we also think about that every day at Matter, and I'll tell you a little bit more about it as we move forward. So Pam, we'll start with you. So how is innovation, particularly in global health, creating solutions that improve maternal and childhood health and survival?
That's a great question, thank you. There's lots going on in global health and innovation, and concern has been a part of this largely through an amazing opportunity that was given to us back in 2008 by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation to try to take, and this comes back to the cross-sectoral issues as well, some of the approaches that are used in the consumer industry and in the private sector to drive innovation and apply those techniques in the global health and development space. So this program, Innovations for Maternal, Newborn, and Child Health, did exactly that. We were challenged to say, how can we go to the poorest, the areas of the world with the highest death rates among moms and young children, the poorest places, and actually crowdsource creative new ideas that would bring innovations to accessing care for women, babies, and children. We said, can we crowdsource? Can we listen to the voices of people who haven't been heard but who are living and breathing these challenges in their daily lives in countries across Africa or South Asia? And can we, from that, develop new ways, bold new ways, to improve lives and save lives for women and infants and children? And so that's what has been kind of our MO, taking approaches in social innovation from other sectors and trying them out. For example, user-centered design, human-centered design. You know, that's why our iPhones are so seductive, right? Because Apple just works intensively and understands everything about how we want to experience our phones and what they do for us and what our challenges are and how that can make it better. And so we took those same approaches and worked with users in settings like a rural community of Ghana, so a mother of a young child, or a community health nurse who is out there visiting homes in tough village areas where, you know, she's walking for miles into the hot sun, not supported. Just to give quick examples of where that has led us, that community health nurse now has her own smartphone app that can provide point-of-care guidance, that can provide continuing education credits, that can connect her to her peers to help her get real-time help to diagnose something maybe that she hasn't seen before, that can provide tips for her to feel healthy and connected out in these areas, and that can help her plan and be supported more closely by her supervisor. So that's the kind of thing. Some of it is techie, some of it is very basic, but there are so many ways, I think, that innovation is now coming into the global space, and it's a very fun time to be in that space.
On the theme of supporting women around the world, Funmi, so inequitable distribution of resources has an impact on women around the world. So can you discuss the importance of partnerships and innovative solutions to help address that?
Absolutely. So as I was saying, so we have Gates Foundation that's really gone out there to help women and children all over the world. Dangote Foundation and philanthropy really coming together to say governments can't do it alone. And now universities are engaging in global health. So we have a consortium of universities in global health. And what we are really trying to do is to partner with NGOs. Take the example of crisis in Africa. Everyone goes out when there's Ebola crisis. And then what happens when everyone pulls out because they don't want to die during the Ebola crisis? There are people who are living in these countries who need to take ownership of their health, and there needs to be investment to actually have partnerships with communities. So universities, like our university, will partner with universities on the ground, partner with foundations who are doing work on the ground, NGOs who are doing work on the ground. So as we deploy new technology and as we deploy innovations to actually improve health, that people would have ownership of it. So I always talk about the fact that Americans are charitable. We have missions going to every village in Africa. We have cell phones in everybody's hands. But what we don't have are good health systems, you know, community health centers. When I came to this country, there were no community health centers on the south side of Chicago. And yet we know prevention is better than cure. You would have to leave your community and take 4 buses to come to Cook County Hospital to get health. But now we have federally mandated community health centers all over this country because we know that to have preventive medicine, you have to have access in your community. And that's what we need to have both in this country and across the world, strengthening health systems. We need to have universal health access to insurance, right? Health as a human right means that if you have a catastrophic illness, you need to be able to get to somewhere where you have experts that can actually help you. So there's no point for us to screen for breast cancer if there are no surgeons or doctors who can actually treat you if you have breast cancer. So we begin to really look at how we can strengthen systems both in this country and across the world, so that people, wherever they live, will have access to not just minimal care, but care that they need and when they need it. So I'm really very interested in community partnerships. As you asked me, Cancer IQ was focused on people who live in Peoria, right, who want to collaborate with universities across the world. With technology, with cell phones, we can all do this. And I think that that's really what's exciting about the period we're going into now, where we look at what assets do people have in their communities, how could we leverage those assets to improve their health?
Thank you. So the issue of partnerships and collaboration comes up over and over again at Matter. So especially when it comes to bringing innovative solutions into the marketplace, it's not just, if you're an entrepreneur, you're not just a vendor with your end customers. So in Faye's case, it's a OSF health system in Peoria. They're really a partner because you have to work with them, and the individuals in that organization have to work with the entrepreneur to really understand how the solution's integrated into workflows and how best to develop something that will suit the needs of of the customer. So so we have about 70 partners that Matter that represent different stakeholders in industry, and in each case, it's really a partnership when we have the entrepreneurs work with the organizations. So moving on to the next section, improved health outcomes. Also a topic that's on top of mind, but one that's likely to stay in the U.S. So value-based care, so moving from fee-for-service to value-based care is largely a bipartisan belief. So it's here to stay. What does it mean at the global level? So more companies are becoming aware of different social engagement pathways, from philanthropy to corporate social responsibility and shared value initiatives. So where on this spectrum is Horizon, and how does your organization think about branching out?
Yeah, that's great. The challenge is there's so many places to invest, right? They're almost unlimited. And so what we've tried to do is focus in four main areas, children's healthcare, innovation through groups like Matter, STEM, and then all of our therapeutic disease areas. One success story maybe here, just right here in Chicago. We came to realize through working with Mount Sinai Hospital that they had a very high readmission rate on certain procedures. And their own assessment of what happened was that the patients weren't taking their medications after they left the hospital after the procedure. So upon doing additional work, what came out was the patients very often, women and children, poor patients often could not afford even the copay for the medication, so then they didn't take the medication, which led to a readmission and an increase in overall cost to the system. And so through Mount Sinai's leadership and a program that we built from the ground up, Horizon will now pay for any copay for any product for a patient leaving the hospital. And the barrier is not show us your income. The barrier is if you say you can't afford it and you need help, we'll take care of it. So it's early in the program, but the early metrics are very successful with the patient's uptake. So that's one example.
Thank you. So go ahead. Did you have? Yes, absolutely.
I think this whole concept of moving from traditional philanthropy to corporate social responsibility that's strategic to what's now called creating shared value is so fascinating. Just to maybe define that last term, companies can create shared value when they address an unmet social need in a way that also brings value back to their business. So the sharing of the value is that you create value for society in the way you address a problem or a need that exists and hasn't been addressed, and you also create value for your company, for your competitive advantage, for your, you know, ability to be in markets or in many other ways that have a business benefit. So that is very pertinent, even for an organization like Concern. You know, we work in the poorest parts of the poorest countries of the world, and sometimes we even try to go to the poorest households in a given community selectively because of the need to improve equity and get people out of poverty. But even there are opportunities for companies to be involved. So one example, there's one I wanted to give, but maybe I'll give a different one because it's better for this point. One of the innovations we came up with that was innovative for its context was in Malawi, which is very poor down near the bottom with Democratic Republic of Congo and Ethiopia in terms of economic development. people have poor access to health services and walk long distances, and yet the clinics are oversubscribed and providers are stressed out by the demand on those facilities that do exist. So the innovation that grew out of this crowdsourcing process there was, well, let's have a hotline, you know, a free place that is staffed by nurses, maybe a doctor to back it up, where a mom could call. You know, that might be normal here, but it didn't, I guarantee you, didn't exist in Malawi, and yet cell phone penetration is decent. So that allowed women to call and either be told, yes, you should come to the health center, or no, that fever or that diarrhea that your kid has, you can manage it at home or through the pharmacy, something you can buy without having to go. And that program, which started just in one district, and then I should add, it was combined with a voice and text messaging service that would be customized. So you would sign up maybe when you're in your first trimester of pregnancy, and you'd have messages via either voice or text that would be keyed to your stage of pregnancy and then the age of your child, you know, maybe developmental milestones or nutritious foods. And so this was a real asset for women. And what has happened is we've attracted support from different government donors, the German Technical Cooperation, Merck for Mothers on the corporate side, and that program has grown. And the reason it's relevant is that at a certain point, our local implementing partner, Village Reach, was approached by Airtel Malawi, the largest mobile provider in Malawi. And they had a service called Dial-A-Doc. It was different. It was a menu-driven. It was a poll system where you dial in. You can get advice on lots of health topics. And they wanted to merge with our program. So now we've gone from one district to eight districts, and we're going to be in the 28 districts of Malawi by the end of 2017. And that is a win-win partnership. Why? Obviously, for families, it's great to have this service and have access to information. But for Airtel, it's great too, because they have better subscriber loyalty. They're making all the airtime free for people, and people love the service, and they stay longer as subscribers to Airtel. And by the way, there is competition, and you know, there are other providers in Malawi. So I think that's a great example of where companies can be involved in ways that really attack problems that are, you know, affecting people and can be beneficial to their businesses as well. And there's other examples I'd love to give you, but that's one in any event.
Thank you. So we're going to ask one more question and then move on to the audience questions. So please feel free to continue to look at social QA, and we'll also take sort of questions directly from the audience in about 5 minutes. So for the last question, can any of you sort of point to an initiative where you tried to improve health outcomes and had some success, but also some challenges? And tell us what those challenges were.
Okay, well, I guess I can start, because one of the things that we have done at Special Olympics is actually stepped beyond the healthy athlete screenings that we provide, and we're now providing for healthy communities. And healthy communities is all about, because you talked about partnerships so much before, but it is all about creating partnerships and working with governments, working with universities, working with local health services to make change. And really, it's about systems change, and it's about people uniting together to ensure that provision is made for people with an intellectual disability. And that program is also funded by a donor, by the Golisano Foundation, which is another great partnership that we have to ensure that it happens. And we really have seen so many great things happen with many of our athletes who have come through our screenings and through the follow-up care that they have received through the Healthy Community Project have made just enormous differences to their entire health and to their functioning, and added years to their lives. We had one athlete actually from Southern California, Dustin Plunkett was his name, and Dustin went to one of our health screenings, and his mouth was very sore, and never been picked up before until he went to the dentist, and at the health screening, and he was diagnosed with gum cancer. And that had never, ever been picked up before. And he went through the procedures, had some teeth removed, and made a full recovery. And actually, he was a co-host for our games in 2000 and... 2 years ago, actually, 2015 in LA. He was a co-host presenter with the ESPN. And here's somebody whose life could have been so much shortened by not having the services that he requires. So it is really about working in partnerships, change. We absolutely need systems change so that there is sufficient equity for people with intellectual disability, and it works where there is, definitely.
Yeah, I think in the area of chronic non-communicable diseases, really having interventions to bring healthcare to communities all over the world, doing task shifting. For example, the gains we have made in maternal mortality, reducing maternal mortality, has been because now, you know, there was a goal to get every birth attended and to help mothers as they give birth. And so in women's health, we've made significant progress. And take the example of breast cancer. If you have access to screening and you have access to quality care, women can expect to live, because breast cancer is treatable. So in Chicago, black women in Chicago were twice as likely to die from breast cancer. And the Chicago Metropolitan Task Force and a lot of us talking about partnership, you know, NGOs, Susan G. Komen, pharmaceutical companies, all came together and said, this is unacceptable in our city. And globally, it's unacceptable. And so we're coming together to raise awareness, number one, and two, to bring pharma to the table, to increase access to clinical trials. And when you have not studied a population, how can you sell drugs to them? So part of what we really need to do with revamping our healthcare system and delivery of care is to take all those clinical trials to communities where people live. And it doesn't matter where they live, whether they're poor or not poor. Our job is to make sure that happens. So by coming together in Chicago, we have 40% reduction in mortality for black women in Chicago. That's not good enough, right? Until we reduce inequity and we reduce disparities, we can't say that we have done anything successfully. So that's an example of what may work, but it's still not successful until everyone has a chance to survive a diagnosis of breast cancer.
Thank you. So we'll move on to some questions. And we also have someone walking around with a microphone. I believe she's in that area. Is that right? So if you have a question that you'd like to ask in person, please go up to the woman who's standing over there and ask your question. So I'll start with one on social QA. So in the future, will non-government organizations, governments, or the private sector be the most impactful change makers? I would say all of them together, right? Working together.
I would definitely say all of them together. I mean, they say it takes a village to raise a child, and it does. It takes entire communities working together to make change happen and to make systems better. And I think when government joins together with the NGO sector, joins together with businesses and the donor community, I really think great, great things can happen, and we can see wonderful change as a result of that.
Sure, Pam.
I know George will want to talk, I think, but I'll set it up for you. I'm going to go out on a limb. I think private sector actually has the hugest potential, because when we look at innovation or at anything in healthcare or any other field, where you have a novel, bold solution, if you can not get past that small proof of concept, small scale program, if you can't reach scale, you're really nowhere. And that's what we call the valley of death in innovation. You know, if you have something great, you know it works, but you just can't get the financing to grow it. And that's where private sector really can come in. So for example, we in Kenya, we're dealing with, you know, there's a lot around drugs, but there's also a lot of challenges around devices and equipment, in, especially in poor countries. So you have equipment that was, you know, ordered from international companies, and it breaks down. It's not used to the rigors of a, you know, developing country setting. It had, you know, electricity spikes, dust, constant use, and so on. It's a huge issue. And one of our innovations was to figure out how can we get local nurses talking to local engineers, tap into the spirit of the kind of maker and hacker community that exists in a country like Kenya, and develop locally design and develop equipment that is better suited. And this was focused on labor and delivery. So we've been doing that. We linked the Kenyatta National Hospital maternity ward clinicians with engineers and designers at the University of Nairobi, created kind of a hub there, and have identified devices which are now being prototyped and tested. The point is, we would never be able to scale that up. Concern as an NGO, and the Kenyan government probably not either. But Philips, the Dutch health technology company, became interested in this work. Philips cares about African markets, and they have been there for a long time, and they have a long-term perspective that they can be in Africa profitably. I mean, they're profitable now probably anyway, but they said, oh, let's invest in this. So we now have a three-way partnership, Concern Worldwide, UNICEF, and Philips, and to me, that's beautiful, because if you can make a profit, then your thing is infinitely scalable, and you just have to adapt how you do business. You know, maybe you're going to have a little more modest expectation around profit or a longer time horizon, or you're going to reconfigure your product, or you're going to look at your value chain and find a different way to do it that is more suitable for the base of the pyramid consumers, but there's a lot you can do. So even though I'm working for an NGO, I have huge faith in the ability of private sector to solve a lot of our most pressing problems. So I don't know if that sets you up, George, but...
Thanks, Pam.
Let's hear from George.
Hi. That's great. This is a kind of a founding principle of ours as well, in that there is so much finger pointing. They're blocking innovation. They're the reason price increase. This is happening because of this group. And I think the change that needs to happen, in our opinion, is that we need to stop looking at this as them and they, and it's really us, right? And that's across all sectors, whether it's government, private, NGO, whatever it might be. If we I've only been doing healthcare for 25 years, which is like it seems so long to me, but such a small blip of time. But in that time, I've watched the patient get lost, right? And that can't be solved by one group or one individual. It has to be an us and a we, not a them and a they.
Okay, I will say something because I'm a doctor, but really, I think the communities with good leadership will solve their own problems. Because health is not the absence of disease, right? We need political will, so we need to grow leaders that actually care about their people and improving the health of everyone, not just the rich. So if you can have healthy communities that are thriving because they have jobs, they have work, their children can go to school, they have a good physical environment to stay healthy, they're going to live longer. The biggest achievements we've made in health have been in public health, right? We don't have a good public health infrastructure in this country, so we build up hospitals. We actually have a better chance of doing more in the global space where people have nothing, and we can develop a healthcare system that is affordable to all and that keeps people healthier, and we can get more out of the investments that we make in communities. So I would say that having leaders with the political will to improve the health of their communities will get us, yes, they will get all the stakeholders together, but they will be leading the way to improve the health of their communities. So for the students that are here, I hope you'll become leaders that will go to your community and improve the health of your communities.
That's wonderful. So, so sometimes roles of, say, the Dangote Foundation, there's a great example of how they created a microfinancing program to help start small businesses. And you know, what's so great about it is, yes, okay, some external party was giving a small amount of money to help these individuals in a community start a business, but it developed a sustainable platform that the actual community developed, right? So they had no control over what startup was actually built or how it was sustained. They just kind of seeded the effort, and that's...
Absolutely, yeah. And what I think people in these communities are looking for, mm-hmm. it's not really always to look for aid and charity. They want to participate in a global enterprise. Mm-hmm. They want to participate in global development where these women, we've seen a lot of faces of women who are hustling every day to feed their family. And we talked about microfinance. They're women who have started businesses mm-hmm. and they're looking to partner with people to loan them money, but they have nothing for security. Those are the people we should be looking for, investing in them so they can, through enterprise, develop their communities. So I think that the Dangote Foundation is really doing a lot of really innovative work to try and get money in the hands of women and have that money translated into a new business.
That's great. So George's point is also really interesting, that patients are lost because the individuals who work for all the organizations that we've described are patients. And somehow their perspective is lost. It's an interesting point. So do we have any questions from the audience? I think we have a woman over here who has a question. No? Oh, yes.
Thank you. I wanted to ask George a little bit more about the business model. I mean, as Pam mentioned, the private sector is so important. Well, all the sectors are important, but when you specifically point out that the company gave away $1.4 billion, and that actually exceeds some of your sales, but you, I'm not sure if you're a publicly traded company, but you certainly have shareholders and owners. How do you sell that kind of support for these programs to the people who also need to make a return on their investment? How does that work?
Those are interesting conversations. I would say that our investors believe in the model. Our board believes in the model. To be clear, our gross sales are more than what we give away, right? It's the net sales that are less. And that number, by the way, has grown every year since we laid it out. But the model basically says that when a prescription is written for a patient, a commercial patient, government's a little bit different and has to be handled separately. But for a commercial patient, there are thousands of ways that patient has access to medication, right? Usually through their health plan. And there's so many different barriers within their own health plan that they're paying for to push towards certain formularies or not allow certain access before trying other drugs. I could probably do a whole talk on this. And what we say is, you know, the patient needs the medication now, let's pay for it. And so we pay for it, and the patient gets the drug within 24 hours. So it's a program that I'm happy to say that there's at least two other pharmaceutical companies that are smaller than us that are starting to deploy the same model in their business as well.
Thank you. So we have time for two more questions, so I'll get going. So if the ACA is repealed, what role, if any, does the private sector have in protecting the health of their underinsured employees?
You're looking at me.
I guess it's you,
so,
yeah.
I'm going to speak just for myself and probably Horizon. We feel that we have a moral obligation, right? We have we're in this business, and we have to focus on patients. All of us in the private sector, we make our livings because of the illnesses of others. And at Horizon, a lot of that, those patients are us, right? Those people are us. And so we take it a little bit more seriously than other places I've worked in the last 25 years. But I think we have to continue to innovate. Places like Matter are critical because in our daily jobs, we're not necessarily thinking about the innovation that can come out and some of the needs that are out there. You know, these innovation hubs, like you're running, bring incredible ideas that we can get behind and bring better care to patients. But we have a moral obligation to be part of the solution.
So since this is really important, I don't want to accept the fact that if ACA is going to be repealed, I want you all to text your congressman and say, do not repeal ACA, okay? Because all of the organizations that we support, and I as an oncologist cannot imagine that any patient with cancer in this country would go without insurance or would have to go and figure out how to get access. Right now, even women with insurance with a breast cancer diagnosis have a hard time figuring all of this out. It's very nice that companies would tell you to come and get a drug and we'll give it to you free. But can you imagine if you have low literacy, or you have disability, or you have no family support, how are you going to access those things that are there for you? Health is a human right, and this country has to think about the most vulnerable of us. So global health is also local health. We cannot care about women all over the world and think that everyone in this country should not have health insurance. So I don't know what we're going to do. ACA may be a little bit needs fixing, but we all have to get together to fix it. There's no doctor in this country that wants us to have 40 million uninsured Americans. It's just not morally right. So I hope ACA doesn't get repealed.
I think that's a wonderful conclusion to our panel. Thank you so much for that final statement. So our time is up. I think it's time for the next one. Thank you so much for sharing the stage with me. It was an honor. And that's it. Thank you.